Yesterday we saw some of the aspects of observations, satellite techniques, and several other issues. Today we will discuss some of the how to do with modeling projections, and then in the afternoon comes the attribution. It's just to give you an example of things going on now that have started after the IPCC report released in 2013-2014. Based also on the Paris Agreement of what is called the dangerous climate change, the World Bank produced a report, Teardown of the Heat, which is basically why we should avoid a warming of 4 degrees centigrade in the future, 2100. And it's basically the worst scenario. We will explain a bit more in terms of those RCPs, or representative concentration pathways, that we discussed yesterday, to see that some of those projections actually lead to a global warming of 4 degrees mean average. In case of continental regions, this warming could be even higher. And in this report that you find in the site of the World Bank, it's interesting because they do some several analyses of, for instance, impacts on health, in water resources, in energy, and several other places, and biodiversity also, of a dangerous climate change. Dangerous climate change is something that we should avoid. Otherwise, if we reach this limit, I mean, there is nothing we can do. Adaptation actually is unfeasible in there, or it's extremely expensive. So this kind of report may be helpful for some of you. And some of you also, I know that you didn't pray this morning, so you can pray now. The encyclical letter, Laudato Si, which was the report, I would say report, that the Vatican prepared, Pope Francis, or Francisco. It means, actually, it was interesting and very on time, because there is always this debate between science and religion. I mean, and this report, which actually was prepared by a group from the Potsdam Institute of Climate Change and the Pontifical Academy of Science in the Vatican. They wrote it's a publication of almost 30 pages, published in English and several others. But the idea of climate change, I mean, the way that some of us look at climate change for some people would say is warming, but others would think in terms of impacts in population, particularly poor population. And also, in terms of migration, in terms of human condition, human rights, and biodiversity. So if you read this, just at least the beginning, you know, say climate change is a global problem with grave implications, environmental, social, economical, political, and for the distribution of goods. It represents one of the principal challenges facing humanity in our day. Its worst impacts will probably be felt by developing countries in the coming decades. So it means the worries about the possibility of environmental climate environmental change, actually. When we think in climate change and their impacts, we refer to global change or environmental change. And you see, for instance, there are some concerns. I'm not sure if it will be covered in this school, in this course, but several activities, including those from working group on two in IPCC, shows that the children and women are the most vulnerable. That's what we call sometimes climate change and gender. Why women? Because, for instance, in some regions, usually the husband is away working in the city and sending money to the family. So if we have a landslide or floods, woman, the mother in there with the kids, they are the most vulnerable of these kind of disasters. And if you see here, for instance, there has been a tragic rise in the number of migrants seeking to flee from the growing poverty caused by environmental degradation. They are not recognized by international conventions as refugees. They bear the loss of living their lives. They left the left behind without enjoying any legal protection whatsoever. Sadly, there is a widespread indifference to such suffering, which is even not taking place through our world. So it means that the implications, the impacts of climate change go even beyond to what you can imagine, okay? If some of you work in biodiversity, for instance, we are worried about the monkey disappear. We are very concerned about that. But what about the poor population fleeing from drought or war some of these words are related to activities. Particularly the ones, for instance, there have been a paper published, I think, a couple of years ago, that at the time in Syria, the problems started was a drought in there. And in some of these major political events, sometimes the environmental tragic events are the triggering of these kind of mechanisms. So with this, I just want to give you an idea that climate change and global change, it goes beyond of modeling, beyond of whatever you imagine. It has some particular implications. And this encyclical from Pope Francis, it really summarized the whole worries about this. Okay. With that, I just wanted to give you an example of that whatever we are discussing here, it has some practical applications. It's not just an academic activity. Okay, and we should think that climatology and climate change go beyond the limits of something academic. It actually should be something that you can apply. At least in my center, which I work with natural disasters, the research we do is applications. For instance, we want to reduce the number of people that die as a consequence of drought or landslides or floods. Other centers, they predict the rainfall that may be leading to floods or droughts. Okay? So now we are going to start discussing some of the issues of the climate modeling. But in terms of climate modeling, for instance, what's the difference between the latest IPCC report in 2013-14 compared to the previous one? Larger evidence, scientific evidence, increased literature for all regions. That means that they have more studies, more documents for climate change and impacts in regions, particularly in tropical regions. The FIFA 7 report also contains details on regional aspects of climate change than previous ones. So from one cycle to another of climate change, there are many papers published. So there is new literature. And some of the ideas, the intention of IPCC is that push young people to start producing something. So if you, for instance, write a paper in terms of, let's say, climate change in the Pantanal region of Brazil and Paraguay. It's managed to get published. Probably that paper will be referred when biodiversity and climate change studies are discussing this issue in this future report. But as in the past, what's the most troubling aspect of this? It was the conclusion that unless we reduce greenhouse gas emissions, we could reach tipping points that create irreversible damage. Basically, we can reach the 4 degrees warming that may create all sorts of impacts. Okay, so this is one of the points. I mean, the idea of the science provides the evidence, but the application of that evidence comes in reports like the ones written by the Vatican or also in some of the climate negotiations like the Paris Agreement. So the Paris Agreement is basically a decision based on science. And who provides the science? This is the scientific community. And most of the scientific community in climate and applications are involved with IPCC. Okay, of course, it's not just only IPCC. Any paper published by several people from several parts of the world are extremely important. And the only way we can assess how climate will change is through models, climate models. Okay, before they were refer as general circulation models. And general circulation models were useful for climate prediction and weather forecast. But now, the general circulation models at the beginning were only atmospheric. Then have the oceanic models coupled with atmospherics. Then we have the vegetation models. Then we have the aerosol models, atmospheric chemistry models, biogeochemical models. So at the end, we have a models that represents as much as possible the climate system, all the components of the climate system, not all of them, because sometimes we don't know much. But when we say the climate model is a mathematical representation of the climate system, is perfect? No. Okay? No. But we're trying to do our best to represent processes that we already know. Like, for instance, there are some little known physical processes. Mean little known because they exist, but they have not been well documented. And if so, the uncertainties remain. We need observations to validate model. I think somebody asked me, we have the observations, temperature, precipitation, rainfall, sea level. At the beginning, the modeling community, I recall clearly, they said, okay, with our models, we will have climate data from anywhere. We will not need observations. Interesting. Then came the remote sensing community. With satellites, we will not need observations. We will not need models. So each community trying to sell their business. But the idea is that observations are the basic for everything. Without observations, you will be living in a not real world. Because models, they have limitations, and radios and satellite data needs validation. It needs to be validated. The TRIM, for instance, the TRIM satellite is a rainfall. But this rainfall was estimated based on validations in several places around the world. So whatever signal from the satellite will be translated to rainfall. So that's the reason why model validations. And we have some limitation in some regions without coverage. So for some regions with little coverage of data, the validation will still be, I wouldn't say unreliable, but will be less reliable than we would like. How to treat uncertainties in models? As I mentioned before, it's model development. Climate models usually are developed in climate centers. And these climate centers assume that whenever we have a climate model, we may have to be continuously improving this model. New techniques, new numerical analysis, new statistical techniques. So now, instead of climate models, we are talking about Earth system models. Okay? Because when we think climate models, we're representing only the atmosphere. No. We use, it's called the ESM, Earth system models. The Earth system models actually represent everything, including climate. Are more complex. Few centers in the world, they have these kind of models. And the supercomputing power is improving each time, and the cost is going lower. So any center can have a supercomputer. But when you get a supercomputer, it's like buying a car. You buy your car. You have to be prepared for improvements in your car. You want to fix sometimes and you need pieces to replace. So in the same kind with supercomputers, you need to buy that. In Brazil, for instance, we have one at INPE, at CPTEC. But we were expected to renew that computer park. But with the economical situation now, it was not possible. So we are running, it's like you are running a 1960 car when we are in 2017. And now, since we have several models going around, according to IPCC, it's about 30-something models from the CEMIP-5. We use the multimodal ensemble technique, which is basically the average. I mean, sometimes it's the arithmetical, sometimes it's more like a model type, or depends. But it's the ensemble of the multimodal. Why? Because imagine that you are doing a study using an outlier. Outlier means a model that actually shows, like yesterday, the HAT-CM3 from UK shows extremely dry conditions in the Amazon, where the other extreme shows extremely wet conditions. And most of the model shows more in between. Okay, so the idea of the multimodal helps in reducing uncertainties. And for impacts, vulnerability, and adaptation, sometimes we have to produce high-resolution climate change projections because most of these global models, they run in 100 or 200 kilometers grid. And sometimes for one particular study, we need even higher resolution. We need, for instance, 5 kilometers grid. We can do that through the downscaling. Either dynamical downscaling, which means model, or statistical downscaling. Okay, you will see that more detail whenever we start discussing vulnerability adaptations. Okay. So, as mentioned again, these are some of the processes we know that occur in atmosphere, and that have to be translated in equations, like changes in atmospheric composition, circulation, changes in the hydrological cycle, clouds, biosphere-atmosphere interactions, soil interactions, land-atmospheric interactions, ice sheets, land surface, changes in cryosphere, snow, frost, and changes in land surface, orography, land use, vegetation, ecosystems, hydrology, volcanic activity, human influences, terrestrial radiation, the hydrological cycle, changes in solar inputs, and several projects, processes in there. Some of them are well known. Others, like the aerosols, are still in development. So we can say that the aerosols is perhaps one of the main reasons of uncertainty, because not all models reproduce the aerosols quite well. Okay, so at this time with this, is there any question on coming about that, or perhaps some experience for some of you who works? Is any one of you working with models, with any type of modeling, global, climate, statistical? 1, 2, 3, 4. What kind of modeling do you do? Yes. You. Weather forecast. Okay. Okay. Is there anyone working with land use change models, for instance? And you? Sorry, with you.
Actually, I'm using the next GDP data. Mm-hmm.
Yes. Okay. Okay. So the best idea is try to do the multi-model, because even if you publish something with one model, the reviewers will ask, what about the other models? Okay, so the multi-model perhaps the best way. It's like statistical sampling. As if you have as much as possible larger sampling, you will be available to reduce your uncertainties. Reduce, because the uncertainties will still remain. But the idea of model development is to reduce the uncertainties. Yes? Well, we have the aerosols coming, for instance, from the volcanoes. But we have other type of aerosols coming from the vegetation. Recent paper station also produce aerosols. Okay? And what I mean with aerosols are particles, not gases, particles. So the vegetation is not static, it's dynamic. The vegetation transpire, they do photosynthesis, and they also release some of the volatile components, which is the aerosols. And they just starting to appear these kind of things. And they just is new, something relatively new, so we don't know that much, and we are not able to model that. People is working on the modeling, but that will take some time. Okay, and also some of the aerosol particles, like the CFCs, for instance, which actually some of them are banned in anywhere in the world, but they're still there. Okay, so aerosol is anything that has to do, but it's not gas. Okay, and aerosols, remember that aerosols have this tendency to cool the planet, in the opposite sense that of greenhouse gases tend to warm the planet. Okay? Yes?
When you say that you have to reduce a certain, that kind of like different graph, because say you can model aerosol, but that doesn't mean that you're going to reduce the probability of, for instance, where it exists still, and you have like another, a different kind of interaction that you still don't know.
Yes. Yes.
You are reducing the uncertainty and you're thinking, okay, I'm improving my model. But that doesn't mean that you get it right anymore.
Well, in model development, people who work with model development, I have seen them. I used to work with model development for some time. People start focusing, for instance, in my experience, with land surface processes. We are improving the land surface processes now. We are having several levels of vegetation and soil, so we improve the hydrology. But at the end, what you get sometimes is worse than what you had before. You see, why? We are improving this, but we are not improving the other. So that's what I said. Model development is like tuning. I mean, sometimes you start tune this, and then you have to tune that again, so the things are working fine. But in this kind of modeling, we don't include processes that could happen out of control. Like, for instance, if the Greenland block melts and everything falls into the ocean, the models are not able to to produce that. It let's say if a comet or an asteroid, a meteor hits the world, hits the earth, and start producing millions of tons of aerosols that can cool the planet, we can get into a new glacial time, ice age. But the models don't include that. You see, the models include basically the processes that we know that gradually are affecting the planet. But things like volcanic eruptions, for instance, the model doesn't predict volcanic eruptions. But it includes volcanic eruptions based on the experience on what we have some previous volcanic eruptions in the past from observation. But the model, if we have a volcanic eruption everywhere in the planet, the models don't get that. So at the end, you will basically get nothing. Okay? But it's like in weather forecast. In weather forecast, for instance, to know the temperature in the next 6 hours, it doesn't matter if the Amazon disappears, because that will basically include the evolving conditions, the initial conditions. Okay, like the cold front is moving, and then you see that. But if we have a volcano at that time, will that affect the weather forecast? Probably no, but will affect the climate later on. Okay, model development is an activity that produces that, and models would say, we tell you that when model development will solve our problems. But as somebody working with model development, it may improve things, but you need to work with the whole system. It's not just improving one process. If you improve one process, you may start complicating other processes. So you have to work with everything. That's the reason why model development is an activity of a center. It's not just one people or one student. Okay? I'm not sure if I answered your question with that. Well, you will see some experts on modeling in the next days, okay? And ask them. Okay. Well, in terms of model structure, the model structure actually represents the processes that may happen in the atmosphere. For instance, in the stratosphere or in the troposphere, in the ocean and land, the interactions between ocean surface waves, land hydrosphere processes, land biosphere, and some of the issues that has to do with convective activity and the energy balance and turbulent fluxes. So all these processes are well known. If you want to go in details, for instance, like ocean waves, there are models for predicting waves in the oceans. Okay, they are, let's say, what we call an application model. If you want to predict, for instance, surface hydrology or landslide, that's what we call an application model, sometimes impact model, that may be run using the conditions from a global climate model. This is basically the structure of the project, of the model. Okay, you have the stratosphere, for instance, you have the ozone layer in there, and we have chemistry processes. If some of you have read about acid rain, in Brazil, we had in the past one oil refinery in nearby Santos, in Cubatão, in the coast of São Paulo. And because of that, I mean, that place is horrible. You go early morning, you will see all this fire coming from everywhere, which from the refineries and from the chimneys. And there were detected cases of acid rain in there. So they have to do changes in the way that they release the aerosols and pollutants, and that problem ended. But in Europe, we have this problem, particularly using coal or oil. Okay, so acid rain, for instance, is something that is known now better than before. Okay, and it's a process that may be complicated things in several places, but at least in Brazil, at least there was a case, but not that much. Okay, but just to give you an example, because the models include also atmospheric chemistry. And atmospheric chemistry, for those of you who work with that, black carbon, for instance, in this city of São Paulo, is one of the most polluted in the world. It's a mega city of 18 million. It's a country, basically. And for those of you who live in rural areas, perhaps you will feel some the pollution in here. Okay, I live in a rural area. Each time I come here, my nose starts, I wouldn't say bleeding, but I feel the pollution in there. And if you go to Rio de Janeiro, for instance, which is another big city, it's almost the same problem. Okay? Well, some of the processes which are extremely important. Like I said, we mentioned here processes that we know that have been studied continuously, like cloud microphysics, for instance, the planetary boundary layer, shallow and deep convection, transition from shallow to deep convection, radiation and clouds, direct and indirect effect of aerosols, interaction between microphysics and cumulus convection, surface atmosphere coupling, vegetation response, which include actually opening or closing of the stomach, ocean circulation, sea surface temperatures, boundary layer, humidity, and convection. For instance, there have been some studies in the southern part of the Amazon. A couple of studies that shows that the aerosols coming from the biomass burning from deforestation, they somewhat affect the rainfall. It means like because of those aerosols concentrations, there is a delay on the onset of the rainy season. And that has been observed in southern part of the Amazon based in observations. But you said delay on the onset of the rainy season means a extended dry season. So the glass is full, half empty, it's the same thing. For some people it's important the beginning of the rainy season, like for agricultural activities, is the beginning of the rainy season. But for people working with fires and fires modeling, it's extremely dangerous to have a length of the dry season longer, okay? I think as answer to your question also, the aerosols, they have impact in terms of the hydrological variables, particularly the rainfall. It has been proved in several papers in the southern Amazon that the aerosols coming from the biomass burning, they affect the beginning of the rainy season, meaning that they basically make the dry season longer. Okay? And because of the winds, whatever happens in the Amazon, it may be felt anywhere, including in the La Plata basin, southern Brazil, northern Argentina. Most part of the rainfall coming to São Paulo or to other regions is through the moisture flux from the Amazon region through here. Other part comes from the cold fronts, from the south, coming from Argentina. This is an export product from Argentina. But what happened? It was amazing. Is there any lawyer here? No lawyers? You're a lawyer? Good. What kind of law? Environmental law? Good. There was a situation when we had, in meteorological terms, means like some particular day. In some particular day, you may have like 80% of the moisture in São Paulo coming from the Amazon, from one particular day, weather forecast. And sometimes, let's say this rain produced landslides that kill people. So somebody came with the idea to sue the state of Amazon because they were sending moisture that produced rainfall in excess that killed people. On the other side, the agricultural activity in São Paulo and West Central Brazil is highly technified. I mean, it's commodities, basically. And part of the rainfall comes from the Amazon. So lawyers in the state of Amazonas, they were saying, okay, we want some part of this agribusiness royalties because part of the moisture that fills, that irrigates all of this region comes from the Amazon. So these kind of processes, I mean, if this continues, may have a problem because fires in Bolivia, the smoke in the southern Amazon and Bolivia, the low-level winds may bring this moisture into northern Argentina and Uruguay. And that may affect the air quality and may affect the health of the population. So will it be suitable to have a legal process against Bolivia and southern Amazon because few people die in northern Argentina because of the pollution coming from the forest burning? I'm not sure. I mean, it could be possible. But this is just to give you an idea that whatever happens in one region, it has coming from other region. I mean, climate doesn't respect boundaries. Even in the hydrology in the Amazon, we work as a transboundary basin. Because whatever happens in Manaus, which is central Amazon, it depends on rainfall coming in the highlands of Peru and Bolivia, which is mean basically the beginning of the Amazonas. The Amazon River is in Peru, in the highlands of Peru. So whatever happens in Peru will have impacts in Manaus, central Amazon. Okay, so the climate is well connected. And what happened? In the Amazon, for instance, we have high convective activity. Okay, in the Amazon, we have a strong vegetation coupling, vegetation response. And in the Amazon, we have interactions between microphysics and aerosols. But in the tropical Atlantic and Pacific, we have moisture transport from one region to another. So you can imagine at this time, everything is working together. Get access to any website, for instance, CEPETEC, and you will see the satellite images in there. And you will see, for instance, rainfall in some regions in the northern part of South America. But you don't see rainfall at this time in São Paulo because it's the dry season. Dry, in quotes, because it means that it rains, but it rains very, very little. Okay? And those, all of these processes have to do with happening in nature. That's the reason why they are part of the processes, including climate modeling. Do we know this all well? Well, at the beginning, we knew about convection, boundary layer. Later, we start improving our knowledge in vegetation response, because at the beginning, we assumed that vegetation was like a green carpet, only green color, with an albedo of green color. But in reality, the vegetation reacts. The vegetation responds to climate. There are interactions between climate and vegetation. In some places, vegetation is a consequence of climate. But climate also is a consequence of vegetation. Okay? And then in this case, later on, we start to work with aerosols. Okay? So things are improving, are getting better, better, but it's a very slow process. Because doing good things in terms of modeling and mathematics, it takes time. It's nothing that will be done from 1 year to another. It takes actually, I wouldn't say decades, but it takes generations of scientists. Many PhD students, they work with some particular component of this in the PhD work, and they continue as a postdoctoral activities. But still, it's a long process to go. Just to give you an example, why we use computer models to study climate change. As I mentioned before, climate change is something that may happen in the future. Climate variability is what we happen now. And to project things, we need climate models. The evolution of climate, sometimes it is a response to increasing atmosphere CO2. This cannot be done the laboratories. I mean, I recall I used to, in my biology classes several years ago, we have these experiments and you have a plant in there and then you start injecting CO2 and you see that this plant seems to be growing and growing. This is what we call the CO2 fertilization. But there is a limit when you have feed the vegetation with CO2. Later on, it just falls. But those things, like in the atmosphere is not, cannot work as a laboratory because it's open. Okay? So there are processes in there. We also are unable, the models are based on mathematical equations that represents the different processes that we know. The most comprehensive climate models, which are the Earth system models. I mean, when I say climate models, I mean really Earth system model, because it includes several of the components of the reality. And they are able to simulate the climate. When I say simulate, is simulate the present climate. And to project the climate for the future, this is, let's say, the what we went with climate change. Climate change is a projection of the future. It's not a prediction. If somebody asks you, for instance, well, we need to know if Northeast Brazil will be 4 degrees warmer in 2060. The only way to check that is through climate models or Earth system models. As I mentioned before, the models start to be developed in the 60s as a consequence of the Cold War and possibility of having a winter, a permanent winter because of the possible war between U.S. and the former Soviet Union. And then we toss these atomic bombs everywhere, everyone starts to put in fire, and then we will see a reaction, probably a cooling of the planet. But there are some processes like El Niño that has been started to be considered. The El Niño is a phenomenon that happens in the past, but after 1980, 83, that events that killed many people in several places in the planet, there was really an intention that we should do some work with El Niño. We need to observe El Niño. We need to monitor El Niño. That's the reason why we saw this array of buoys and automatic platforms across the Pacific to monitor El Niño. And with monitoring, we may be able to predict El Niño. We want to know, for instance, at this time, there was a risk that we may have El Niño in the next summer, I mean, Southern Hemisphere summer. But so far, the monitoring doesn't show that so far. But things are changing that much from one month to another that maybe next month we will see some signals of early El Niño. The projections are the most prominent features of long-term human-induced climate change. CO2, with the models, you can increase the concentration of CO2, run the models, and see how is the climate coming. Okay? This is basically a projection. Is perfect? No, it's a projection. It's a possible scenario what could happen. Is this going to happen? Probabilities are high. But if we have a sudden warming and melting of melting of Greenland, for instance, that may change everything. The models don't use that. And also, we may have to explore some particular issues. For instance, let's say, at this time, we're starting to feel that the permafrost in Siberia is melting, and all this huge volume of methane is going to be released into the atmosphere. We didn't include this huge volume of methane as a consequence of the permafrost melting. You know what permafrost is, right? It's the frozen soil in the northern part of Asia, Siberia particularly. And if this frozen soil starts to melt, all this methane starts to release in the atmosphere. So we may be able to model the consequences of that. Let's say in the model we increase by 500% the volume of methane, because whatever methane is released, the winds will transport this methane everywhere in the planet. And we may be able to simulate what would happen with that climate for that. So basically, we're talking about specific experiments. If you want to simulate the deforestation, that's what modelers do. Let's say we cut totally the trees in the Amazon. You cannot do that in reality, but you can do that in the model. Let's see what happens. And the warming increases in South America. The moisture flux is complicated. The same thing happens in the Sahel in Africa. I remember people from University of Maryland, they did an opposite experiment. They sort of forested the Sahara region. So they put a forest in the Sahara region. What could happen as a consequence of foresting, reforesting the Sahara region? And you see climate changes in there. The regions get humid, and other places of the planet get humid. So these kind of experiments you can perform quite well with models. Models are tools, okay? And with those tools, what? Ah, claro. ¿Cuál es la temperatura que está ahí? 20. It's global cooling. Too many aerosols in there, so you're cooling for that. No, I mean, it's cold. I mean, feel free to raise the temperature, but not 25, please. No. Otherwise, this really becomes like a sauna. No, no problem. Now mentioning in terms of temperature, I remember one of those in Brazil, we have each 2 years our conference on the Brazilian Meteorological Society. And once I was part of the review committee. And we review abstracts like any conference. There was an interesting abstract from a meteorologist student in Porto Alegre, which is the southernmost state of Brazil, the capital of Rio Grande do Sul. And she went in the emergency room, start counting people, how many people came for almost the whole summer with signs of violence, with basically being starving, fighting, shooting. And just that evidence and correlated with temperature, she shows that warming temperatures make people more violent. That was her conclusion. It was basically a work from one student going there and counting and things like that. So it was interesting because there are few studies now that show that. Okay, but the observation of that students were actually keeping the attention of everyone. It makes sense. It makes sense. For instance, if we get this wool very, very warm, you will start feeling uncomfortable. And when you feel uncomfortable, you feel a little violent. I wouldn't say violent, what sense? But you feel uncomfortable, meaning like, ah, please stay away from me. You are too warm, things like that. So just to give you an example of what could happen in a warm planet. A warm planet, people start fighting each other. But not because of the warming from the neighbor. It's basically because we may have been lacking of water, lacking of food. And you have to make your worse as a consequence of that. Okay, so it's, let's say the laboratory. We have a laboratory in here, and let's experiment with 32 degrees centigrade. Let's see what happens. Well, for some of you, this may be quite simple, but the models in general, we call general because they run the whole planet, and the equations are solved in a grid box. So each one of these grid boxes, for instance, 1 kilometer, you have vertical processes, we have lateral processes with interaction, we have upper atmosphere, lower atmosphere, and all the equations are resolved from this particular grid box, which actually interacts with the neighboring grid box. That grid box, for instance, could be ocean, could be part of ocean and continent, could be exclusive continent, could be also highlands, could be ice. So the model is a resolve for grid boxes. That's the reason why we need supercomputer, because this takes time, a lot of time. And some of the calculations, some of the variables that we use are temperature, humidity, wind direction, geopotential height, which actually I would say are the variables that the model use. And then as a model output, you have anything you want. You may have, for instance, temperature at 10 meters, you may have moisture fluxes. We have several types of information. Okay, so the mathematics of the models, the idea of the mathematics is the same. The processes are the same. The problem is the difference with how you represent each process. For instance, in convection, at the very beginning, we start working with the Arakawa-Schubert parameterization because it was a development of the cumulus convection modeling through the people from University of California, Los Angeles, Professor Arakawa and Schubert. And later on, it came Professor Grell. And later on, it came others and others and others. Each one likes to put their names in their models, schemes. All of them resolve the same processes, but in a different way. That's why you have different responses from the different models. Okay? So, this is sort of the evolution of the modeling, the coupled climate models. In the 70s, the models represent atmosphere, land surface, and ocean and sea ice. And time, new colors, and if you see the cylinder gets a bit thicker. We have more knowledge in here than in here. So it means like in the evolution of climate modeling, we started to learn more about the processes as compared to the 70s, and we started to include more processes that were not in the past. And when you have here mid-70s, mid-80s, FAR, it's the first assessment report of IPCC, second assessment report, third assessment report, 2001, fourth assessment report, 2007, and fifth assessment report, 2013. So it has been improving. And look at, for instance, in the 70s, for the second assessment report, aerosols started to appear, to be including models. From the third assessment report, we have carbon cycle, vegetation. And for the last assessment report, we are including atmospheric chemistry, with aerosols are including here also, and land ice. What does it mean? That each time the model development allows us to understand a process much better and to include new processes that we don't know now. Or we need, sorry, we didn't know in the past, but we know more. There is room for improvement, yes, because there are other processes that it may be there. We don't know them, and we don't know them. We don't know how they work, and if we don't know how they work, basically we don't know how to represent them mathematically. Okay? But you can see the differences in 40 years, how the model is evolving, and also, of course, the supercomputer. At INPE, we used to have a Japanese SX3, a Japanese supercomputer. The Japanese computer actually was bigger than this, the whole room. Now, that computer, it has the same power that one of your laptops. Okay? The ones we have, the 2 pound, as mentioned by Professor Newton, La Scala yesterday, is not as big, but it's more powerful. And each time, the computers are getting more powerful and smaller. In the past, nobody knew, for instance, about the possibility of having notebooks you have to bring with your old desktop. And now, you can run a model with a notebook. For instance, the PRESI model, which is the regional climate model from the UK Met Office, you can run in your own notebook. Just starting to run, leave it in there for a couple of weeks, and then you have your model output. No need for supercomputer. Or other groups that are working with clusters of computers, okay, which usually you can also start doing your work. But if you want to develop modeling, you have to have the best of supercomputer power, because with this, we are able to interact. Model development is also an international collaboration. Okay. For instance, the model development we do in Brazil, it's a large collaboration with the UK Met Office, with ENSEP from the United States, with the Japanese Meteorological Agency. Okay, so the scientific community working model development is not big, but we interact internationally because that's the only way it works, called international collaboration. Otherwise, without international collaboration, you are an example of these things don't go that well, because somebody can start doing the same thing in southern Brazil, somebody can start working on the same thing in Argentina, same process, same data. It will be nice to work together and we get more knowledge and more people, more brains working on these kind of activities, okay? So in terms of the resolution, when we talk about model resolution, space resolution. As I mentioned before, the size of the grid box is what we may refer as a resolution. This is Europe, okay? And this is a grid box from 87.5 kilometers, and this is a grid box from 30 kilometers. So with the grid box get smaller, we refer to higher resolution. And with the higher resolution, we get more a much better representation of the surface and all the processes coming into surface. For instance, think about this, the Andes. The Andes, about, let's say, 5,000 meters. With a global model, low resolution, you see the Andes wider and lower. And that has consequences because the moisture coming from the Atlantic, that's the moisture coming from the Atlantic. The moisture coming from the Atlantic in real life very rarely crosses the Andes, very rarely. But with the high resolution models with the lower Andes, it may happen that the air coming from one side to Atlantic goes into the Pacific, which actually doesn't happen. So the idea of having higher resolution demanded more computing power that we have already, okay? And in terms of downscaling, you can go even higher. Let's say you want to do climate change projections of fires here in Portugal. You can go as far as 5 kilometers or even 500 meters, but just for this particular region, not the whole planet. Okay, because with the whole planet, you may need to have like Earth simulator type from Japan. Okay, so depending on what you need, you may have to start thinking higher resolution or lower resolution. If somebody wants to work, let's say, with the Congo Basin, for instance, just for the Congo Basin, you may need a higher resolution for that particular region, not for the whole Africa, just for that particular region. Okay? And I'm sure that several groups are working on that. You can take a look at that at the working group 2 report There is a section of working group to report ago regional. And you will see for each region the several studies in terms of observation and climate modeling and impact modeling for each particular continent. In the case of South America, Central and South America. But in Africa, in Southeast Asia, the small islands also, you will see all this information. So I suggest you to take a look at that. It's 2014. By 2021, it will be replaced by the sixth assessment report. But as far as we have now, that 2004 plus the recent literature published in the regional studies are really providing more information than what we used to have in the past. Okay? Question? Yes? Yes, yes, yes. You are right. At the time, I mean, like 5 years ago, this famous Earth simulation was a computer from Japan. They were able to have global model out to 50 kilometers. But they were, let's say, expecting that everyone will use that. And it didn't happen. Why? Because the several countries, they were working in the national efforts to produce downscaling scenarios. For instance, in South America, we start working with global and regional models, and we start getting our projection for the whole South America, 40 kilometers, or even for some particular regions like the state of São Paulo, 5 kilometers. You see? But that was the effort from Brazil. In Argentina also they have done that. And in Spain they have done that. So there are several experiments in there that need some sort of coordination. And what we have now is there is an effort called CORDEX. CORDEX, coordinated experiments. And you will see CORDEX, I think you type CORDEX in the Google, you will see the effort when we have several regional models run with the same global climate models, so you may compare results, for instance, from Europe and Northern Africa or even South America. You see? So, at the end, you can do your own downscaling, dynamic downscaling. The statistical downscaling is the simplest one, but for statistical downscaling, you need data, calibrate that. Sometimes you don't have data. And with elevation, with the Andes, for instance, the statistical downscaling doesn't work.
So I have a question. I know the CORDEX project, but if right now the center have the power of computer, so why each center do this dynamical downscale in a global resolution with a very fine resolution? In order to do multi-model example, for example, in my case, I use the statistical downscale project of NASA,
yeah.
But it not reproduce well the topography, for example, in my country, Costa Rica.
Yeah.
But it's an effort, you know, to use global models in order the in everywhere can study each region for interest of the people.
Yeah.
So, why or what is the reason that if I have the power computation, we don't do this in a global scale?
Well, like I mentioned, the example of the Earth simulation was the most powerful computer, so you get high resolution scenarios from everywhere. But it was only for that supercomputer because. If you see, for instance, the European Center, UK Met Office, they don't run high resolution globally. They don't. That's why they have the PRESIS model, which is the PRESIS model is their regional model, and they teach experiments when you can run the model. We have run the model from South America. People have run the model in India. So this is a regional model, but you go just by region, you see? So it's very unlikely, I could say, that a global models, all global centers start producing downscaling because it doesn't, there is no justification for them to do that. It's like I'm running the model that all of you will use. Good for you, but not for me because I'm spending a lot of money in supercomputer. Instead, I said, I give you my global model output, you start running your own experiments. So you say, for instance, I want to run over Puerto Rico, only. Or I say, no, I want to run for the whole Central American Caribbean. Each one of you decide, you see? And that's the way it has been going for a past. I mean, there are the PRESIS model, there are RIC-CM3, CM4 modeling, the ETA model, for instance, the regional spectrum model. There are several regional models running. And if you see the cortex, you will see a complete list of regional models. Okay? But like I said, I mean, I don't think a center will run high resolution model for everywhere because it doesn't justify. Unless they want to do one particular activity, like IPCC, for instance, they may be able to run for the next IPCC run, but just for that. You see? And some of the problems with this is the space. Sometimes it's so much data that you don't know how to transfer. FTP sometimes doesn't work. Because it's too much volume of data. Now we have the Earth System Grid Federation. But in the past, for instance, when we needed the model output from UK, we have to send someone with a couple of hard disks to get the data and then come back. You see, and sometimes you have to pay the taxes from the airport because they thought that you were buying computer equipment. So it was a complicated. Nothing to do with climate were affecting model runs. And in some places, downscaling has been working, particularly in a small homogeneous region. But in valleys with altitude, or even with the snow, it's limited. But again, it may be possible to do that for some particular regions. I mean, I don't say that statistical downscaling is bad. It's just that it's not as reliable. But there are limitations when you have, for instance, strong contrast between land and ocean, or altitude, or snow. Okay, so there are several levels of downscaling. I mean, I suggest you to check with the Cortex site, and you will learn more about this if you are really interested in downscaling. Okay, and there are several published on that, several papers published on downscaling. I mean, we have more now than we used to have in the 90s, for instance. Okay. Are you familiar with this term, intertropical convergence zone? It's the convergence of the Northeast Straits and Southeast Straits. I mean, I ask this because there are people with no meteorology or climate background, or atmospheric sciences, so it may be hard to understand. But the winds coming from the north and the south, they converge, and with the moist air comes and encounter, they ascend and producing what we call the convective cloud. And those convective clouds produce a lot of rainfall. So what happened? We have the intertropical convergence zone, which is the region of wind convergence, the whole planet, including this region from the Pacific, for instance, and the Atlantic. Okay, so what happened at the beginning with the couple oceans? With the couple oceans, with the oceanic atmospheric, most of these models are starting to show a problem. This problem in particular, the two intertropical convergence zones. We have one, and we have in here, in summer, what we call the South Pacific convergence zone, which is a southeast-northwest convective band coming this way. The same thing as in the Atlantic in here. But what happened? Models don't reproduce the South Pacific convergence zone. They just show it parallel to the intertropical convergence zone. And this the idea of having two intertropical convergence zones in the Pacific. So what is a major problem, because this is totally difficult to explain in terms of climate. How can you explain that? I mean, the winds are coming, but you have twice here. So what happened in between these two tropical convergence zones? So one of the problems that was detected in many of the oceanic models was the representation of what we call the stratus clouds in the Pacific. In winter, so Peru and Chile, normally in winter, cold waters, we have upwelling coming, we have this kind of gray environment, we have the clouds, the stratus clouds, what we call the low-level clouds. And those low-level clouds block solar radiation. So you're changing the energy balance. But the models don't reproduce well those stratus clouds. And if you don't reproduce well this, you may have any problem coming with the models. And one of the problems detected was the double intertropical convergence zone. Okay? It's something that has been improving, but it's still there. So when we have this subtropical convergence zone,
double.
What may happen? Is there a cloud bias over certain oceans, meaning basically the stratos are well represented or not? But if we have less rainfall in a region, we have more rainfall in another. So it's like we have a negative bias in rainfall in one place is because there is raining too much in other side of the planet. Or is a sea surface temperature bias. Sea surface temperature is a variable that you measure, as we showed yesterday. But the oceanic models generate sea surface temperatures also. So you may have observed sea surface temperature and also simulated sea surface temperature. And sometimes they don't match each other. Okay, they don't match well. So there is a problem. There is a bias in there. Or perhaps it's the inter-hemispheric heating asymmetry. Remember that the northern hemisphere, it has a different continental mass than the southern hemisphere. So some of the processes that work well in the north may not work well in the south. And like I said before, models trying to represent as much as possible the best of the reality, that sometimes is not enough. And you have problems like this. So imagine now that this oceanic model is part of an Earth system model. So you are already introducing uncertainties from one component, and these uncertainties will amplify whenever you interact with atmosphere, with ice, with the land surface processes. See? So the best way to start learning and what happened is to start looking into the particular components. And people working with RC interaction, they have detected this kind of simulations. This problem. This is supposed to be like this, but not like this. Okay? And if you are changing rainfall patterns in here, you may be changing rainfall patterns everywhere. I don't say that the oceanic models are wrong. I just said that they started to have these kind of problems. They are improving it because of they need observations in here. Like I said, to validate satellites and models, you need observations in here. There are several crews in there, ships going up and down east and west to start collecting information on boundary layer, on clouds, and temperature and humidity. So in such a way that we may be feeding the models with real observations to see if they improve the representation or not. Okay? So that's the way it works. For instance, if you don't have data for 20 years, what people do? They go to a region, do an intensive field experiment to get all data possible almost every minute for 20 days. Okay? It's like I say, well, I want to have your history of heart disease. I mean, like, do you have your family have a heart attack before? Oh, but I don't have. Okay, let's sit you in one of those bicycles. No, start running and running like crazy for let's say 15 minutes, and then you get all these patterns. Oh, I have your history now in 20 minutes. Something I should supposed to have during 20 years. Okay, this is the kind of things that sometimes field experiments help. It's the only way we know. The best way we know are quite expensive, but the benefits in terms of help the climate community is really very high. Okay? Now with the economic situation, some countries start to think twice about this because of, for instance, in Brazil, we have few scientific oceanographic cruises, ships in there. But because of money, lack of money, some of those are on the port. So they are not going because they don't have the salaries to pay the captain, or the salaries to buy hydrogen, for instance, or gases to fill the balloons. So things like this, actually, if you say you want to know another source of uncertainty, economical crisis is another source of uncertainty, because whatever you do in terms of get modeling and get data to validate your models are really, let's say, out of the question because of economical crisis. Okay. Some ideas of in modeling. Across space, across time scales. Across space, for instance, high resolution modeling. Across time scales, weather forecast, climate change. So many people, the most important variable for many people is rainfall, which actually is the worst variable produced by the models. But everyone wants rainfall. You see, because of importance in hydrology, importance on agriculture. In terms of rainfall, for instance, let's say we would like to know if the next summer in the southern hemisphere is going to be wet or not. So we have to run the models with the condition of sea surface temperature, let's say now, run the model for months, and then we will see the prediction of what will be the next forecast. It's a prediction. Like I said, you run the model, something will come out. We have to see if that is good or not. And the global coupled modeling allows for us to study these kind of things, dynamics, for instance, the winds, and teleconnections. The word teleconnection is basically tele means distance, connection means association. So, for instance, how would you explain the fact that during the Amazon region, during El Niño, we had some tendency for dry conditions? Since the Amazon region is in the other side of the Andes, it's closer to the Atlantic than into the Pacific. Or what happened, for instance, if we have El Niño, it may have impacts on the monsoon rainfall in India. How to explain that? Like I said, something happens in one planet, in one side of the planet, we have consequences in the others. So the information, let's say the forcing, the thermal forcing by the sea surface temperatures warmer than normal, it generates a wave pulse that is transmitted to the other of the planet. Like Rossby wave, Kelvin waves. I mean, I'm not going to give you a wave theory of this. It's just one example. One thing affects the rest. If somebody starts smoking on the back, for instance, these smokes will come here and you will feel it. I'm not sure if you were, perhaps not, at the time that half of the plane was smokers, the other half of the plane was not smokers. I used to travel that. And I can say that I was on the non-smoker section, but the smoke came anyway. You see? So, this, the father of the teleconnections was Professor Gilbert Walker. Gilbert Walker was a meteorologist from UK. He was hired to work in India to do forecasts of monsoon rainfall in India. Why? Because at the time, India was a UK domain, and they depend a lot of tea. And in India, agricultural and lifestyle depends on the quality of the monsoon. So Walker, he starts correlating rainfall in India with pressure in several places in the planet, like pressure in San Francisco and pressure in Valparaíso, in Chile, or Easter Island. But you can see in your map, India is quite far away from San Francisco or Valparaíso. What they have to do with that? And actually, he made correlations. And he was the first using this idea that whatever happened with the atmospheric pressure in some places may have to do with the rainfall in India. Okay? For instance, we have the warm waters in the West Pacific and the cold waters in the East Pacific. And if we have warm and cold, we have pressure. We have high pressure where we have cold water. We have low pressure when we have warm water. So basically, a pressure gradient. So in one place, if the pressure is going down, it's because in other places it's going up. Okay. So the idea of a correlation was actually introducing the idea of a wave connection. So I think, I'm not sure, but I think at the beginning the forecast didn't work out well. But he gave the idea that if we want to check for something going in one side, you have to start looking from other places. For instance, if we have a signal of El Niño, places around the world will be ready because we may have impacts in San Francisco and California. We may have impacts in northern Argentina, southern Brazil. We may have impacts in Amazon and northeast Brazil. We have consequences of dry conditions in Australia, for instance, a lot of rainfall in Guayaquil, Ecuador. Okay? But for that, if you want to model that, you need to represent this. to capture the fine structure of the coupling between atmosphere and ocean. Okay? So atmosphere and ocean, they are not isolated. Why? You have ocean currents, and you have atmospheric circulation. So the ocean currents are somewhat related to the atmospheric circulation. In the southern hemisphere, in the Pacific, we have an anticyclone, which basically means a high-level pressure. High-level pressure is anticlockwise in the southern hemisphere. But if you go down, you see the atmospheric oceanic current, the Humboldt current, actually also clockwise, anticlockwise. So they are related to each other. One produces the other. But because they are different fluids, there will be a difference in speed because the friction. But again, these are several processes that we need to know. And the land use forcing. The land use forcing becomes extremely important because it's something that is happening everywhere. Agriculture is replacing the native vegetation. Cities are growing, so we are changing the surface conditions. If you change the surface conditions, you change the energy balance. And if you change the energy balance, you change the hydrological cycle, and you change basically everything. So in here, the city of São Paulo used to be, in the past, Atlantic forest. Now we have concrete, asphalt, glass, iron, steel, everything, asphalt, to complicate things. And that also has to do with the representation of convective processes and the response to extremes. If you have a city, the city produces their own energy. So you may have this kind of breeze effect between cities and rural areas. See, like convection due to warm and surface conditions in the city, and this is the reason why the city of São Paulo is really quite dangerous during summer, because it rains like crazy in the city, but in the other neighbor regions, it doesn't rain. Okay, there are the changes in land surface processes. And all of them, for instance, land surface processes are extremely important when we work with weather forecast and when we work with climate change, for instance. In climate change, you can assume that the cities is growing. We have another city called Campinas. But if you see the projections of the growing of the cities, those two cities will merge in one in the future. It looks like that. The rate of growing, it looks like Campinas and a metropolitan region of São Paulo will be one. See? And that, of course, will have changes on the land surface processes and in rainfall as well. Well, I think I'm coming back to something that I mentioned before, but in any case, future scenarios. When we talk about climate change, it's different from a forecast. For the future, the next decades or so, or until 2100, we are talking about projections. Okay? But if you think in terms of projections, require assumptions on human activities or natural effects that could alter climate over decades and centuries. For instance, human activities. You say, okay, population is growing. The use of fossil fuel is increasing. Agricultural is increasing, so you have an increase of methane. This is one possible scenario. The other scenario would be, for instance, as I mentioned before, the one that we have reduced, we will reduce the emission of greenhouse gases, and we create methodologies to start taking the CO2, and then we will reach a stabilization, and we will be able to reach a maximum of 2 degrees centigrade. It's a scenario. So these scenarios are more like representations of a possible reality. You know, it goes from simple idealized structure to enforced process understanding, and then to other. And for the previous assessment reports, we used the SRES, the socioeconomic driving emission scenarios. And at the time, for the IPCC, for assessment report, they use what is called the A2 scenario, A1B, B1 scenario. The A2 scenario was the worst one, A1 was the worst one, A1B was the intermediate, and then we have the B1, which was the good model, I would say, at the time. I don't recall what was the name, I think it was, well, anyway. It was the model that actually was the best solution. Meaning that there is adaptation going on, there is a population stabilization, there is a control of greenhouse gases. And use technology, agricultural forest activity, several processes in there. So you need, for instance, to reduce your agricultural activity to reduce methane. That is considered in the scenario. But later on, it came the what we call the representative concentration pathway scenarios, RCPs. These RCPs are more, I would say, physically driven. Physically driven in what sense? In the past, we were thinking more in terms of greenhouse gases concentration. Now we think in terms of radiative forcing. Radiative forcing is a consequence of greenhouse gases. So we don't just check the greenhouse gases, we check the radiative force. Okay? So the consequence of the greenhouse gases instead of the greenhouse gases themselves. And those scenarios have been used for the fifth assessment report. I think they will be used for the sixth assessment report. I mean, as I'm not sure, but what I heard was that the groups don't want to do a lot of work creating new scenarios. Perhaps they will do it for the next 15 years or so. But creating these scenarios, it takes a lot of time. I have been part of the RCP's generation. I mean, you have in a room like this people from the several fields. Meteorology, atmospheric chemistry, economy, agricultural activities. So all the sectors that are involved with the emission of greenhouse gases, transportation, for instance. And it's very, very hard to people start talking to each other because the idea is to do this. What is the best combination of all of our knowledge to produce a set of scenarios when we can say this is the best one, this is the worst one? Okay, it took time. There are reports on that. There are papers published on that. So you can look at them to see actually the differences on those. Okay? And radiative forcing. We consider basically the effect of the energy balance, down minus up, a lower stratospheric temperatures to adjust in radiative equilibrium. So when we have a combination of radiative balance, for instance, more or less coming and going from one particular condition, like 2.6 watts over meter square, that will be different than if we go to the highest, 8.5 watts per meter square. Okay? It will be the same principle of radiation balance, but the amounts of energy coming and going is different. So the equilibrium is different. I mean, you can look at that for more details in other publications, but just to give you an example, in your left, you have the changes in temperature using the SRES scenarios. And like I said, the worst scenario was the red one, reaching almost 3.5 degrees by 2100. And the lowest scenario was B.1, less than 2 degrees. And the red line represents the mean of the models, and the gray, color, the shadow color represents the variation among models. So you can say, for instance, according to the SRS scenario, semi-3 models, warming in 2100 for the A2 scenario could be about 3.5, varying between 3.8 and almost 2.8. Okay? But now, it came the new generation of scenarios, the RCP 2.6, for instance, is the one with stabilization. We didn't have an stabilization scenario here, meaning that the concentration will remain stable in the middle of the century. And this is what we have now. As somebody mentioned, could be useless, because at the time, we are almost in 1.5 degrees. And reaching from 1.5 to 2 actually makes this more like an academic exercise rather than a possible reliable scenario in the future. But gives you an idea of what could happen if we reduce the emissions and we maintain the emissions and keep the emissions negative. What does negative emissions mean? You are taking CO2 from the atmosphere. Okay, this means negative. How do you take CO2 from the atmosphere? Any idea? Carbon sequestration, for instance, afforestation, for instance, more trees, so you can get the photosynthesis more intense and effective. Carbon sequestration, I mean, in some places, like for instance, trying to get the carbon inside holes from the mining industry. But we don't know the consequences. First, we don't know if that's possible or not. In terms of engineering, it's quite expensive, quite expensive. You see? But possible scenario will never happen. But if we go to the RCP 8.5, in 8.5 you have a warming above the 4 degrees centigrade. And that's the target. We don't want to get that because the scientific community, United Nations, the Pope, everywhere, they are extremely concerned with a warming above 3 degrees centigrade. Will be basically the 8.5 RCP. With a warming about 3 degrees centigrade, we may be able to basically reduce the adaptation. Increase vulnerability and reduce adaptation. So basically adaptation will not be effective. It will not happen, actually. You see? But again, those are the two sets of scenarios that have been used. You see there are papers still published with AONWI, B1, B2. But now there are more papers coming with the different RCPs. And there are differences. Like I said before, comparing those two, there are differences. And this is the way that the radiative forcing goes. Observations are in here. This would be closest to the 2.6. You see the radiation forcing reach a level by the meaning of the century and then goes down. And then we have the RCP 8.5, the radiation forcing actually goes up. By 2100, which most of the projections are in here, you see over there. So the evolution of this, most of the model runs goes to 2100, but the new runs are going to 2500. 2500, I mean, is kind of, you're working with impact models, it's useless. If you work with impact models, you want to work perhaps until 2050 or 2040 or 2050, where the changes are not so great, but are still different between one model to another. And let's say this is the radiative forcing again. And for the full lines, that are the RCPs. And for the broken lines are the SRES reports. And you see for each one of them, you have different representations with publications and everything in there. You are going to, as far as I know, you are going to receive a copy of this presentation. So you don't need to copy. But at least to understand that depending on the scenarios, we may have a different outcome. And usually the way most of the papers I'm published are considering the RCP 8.5 because it's the one that shows the largest impacts. Another intermediate is the 0.5, 4.5, that after some particular level, it is stabilized in there. And 2.6 is the one which actually is the best that should be, which unfortunately is not the real situation. Okay, but that's usually the best it should be. And look at what happened. Let's give you what happened. These are the historical runs. The historical means that the model also simulates the present. But in this case, the black line represents observations. Okay? The gray lines represent the present time simulated by the model. Okay, because the models represent also the present. And you see that. There are variations. There is a lot of difference. Intermodal difference is high. But the tendency is going up. And then you have all these spaghetti things, you know, like taking the several models, you see all of the projections. And all of them, they go through a warming. Okay? Perhaps the warming will be lower when we have this RCPs 2.6 or 4.5, and the warming will be higher when we have the 6 and 8.5. Must just give you an idea of this lack of possibilities, okay? A lot of them. And depending on what model you use, on what average you use, you will see a different signal. And this goes only to 2050. Going to 2100, you see that changes may go beyond 4 degrees centigrade. Okay? But this is just to give you an idea of this is what we have now, observe, what we simulate, and what we project in the future. Okay? This is just to give you an example of how the models simulate things. This is from 1986, okay, where the model start to run for the simulation mode. I think I showed this figure before, right? But this is just to give you an idea. The number of models used is in brackets here, 30. That's the reason why you have, for instance, this bar and also the possibilities of warming in there. The shadow represents the intermodal difference. Okay? And ideally, you see that this intermodal difference gets higher and higher and higher whenever you go to the futures, meaning that uncertainties gets higher when you go to the future. If we start working here, for instance, okay, I want to work with 2040. Well, okay, there is not much difference between 8.5 and 4.5, but this difference start to becoming higher after 2050. And 2050 is the time that most of the impacts, like, for instance, the collapse of the Amazon basin, are projected to happen. Okay. Well, as you can imagine also, okay, let me explain this and then we go to the coffee break. For the future projections, when you show future projections, usually are in terms of anomalies. The future minus the present. In this case, the present, it was 1986 to 2005. It's not a WMO determined. It was basically the scientific community that developed the modeling start this period. When we have the RCP 4.5, which means the intermediate scenario. You see the warming, for instance, in South America and Africa goes to 3 degrees. Okay? But if we use 8.5, you see the warming of those regions could go beyond 6 or 7 degrees. Okay, these are the projections. And warming is also in the oceans, not just continent and oceans. So everywhere in the planet you see warming. And in the lower panels you see rainfall changes. Okay? For instance, in percentage. The yellow and light brown is less than 10% changes or even reductions. And in green and blue is increase. Just take one region. Let's say take the Pacific here. You see more rainfall in here, 8.5 compared to 4.5. And in here, the southern part of South America, the La Plata, Paraná, La Plata Basin, you have rainfall increases, and in here, the rainfall increases are higher. But in the present, we have similar situation. In the present, we have already this. Perhaps lower intensity, but we have an increase in rainfall extremes. And in other places of the planet, for instance, in this part of the Horn of Africa, a lot of more rainfall in the 8.5 compared to the 4.5. Okay? So the changes in temperature are on the same direction. The changes in rainfall are on different directions. Some places are getting wetter, some places are getting drier. Yes? The lines represent the agreement in models. I mean, when you see this shadow thing, it's more like more models shows the same signal. Basically, consistency, because you may have a model that shows 0.5 millimeters higher. You have another model that shows 2 millimeters higher. So what this is basically, there is an agreement among models. And that's some sort of indicator that our simulation may be consistent. Okay? Depending on the region you have, you may find different things. This is another figure. And this is the evolution of that. For instance, for the RCP 8.5 temperature, 2016, 2035, and then we are going onto the different scenarios, 8.5, 6, 4.5, and 2.6. And you see, for instance, 4.5 for this and this. This is for 2016, 2035, which is meaning the medium term. And this is for the long term. So what difference you can see? I mean, you can look at and start playing around with the numbers. For instance, the worst scenario would be 8.5 in 2080, 2100 at the end of the century. And if you go to 2.5, 2.6 at the end of the century, the warming is really very, very small. That's the reason why I said this is the kind of warming that Paris Agreement would like to have. We probably will not. So if we are going the same way as we are going now, probably we will be reaching one of those two. Just in temperature. Precipitation will be something similar. I'm not sure if I have it in here. Okay? Excuse me, what? It's the seasonal cycle. Seasonal cycle basically is the contrast between summer and winter. In the tropical regions, summer and winter is something relative. I mean, the summers get warmer, while the winters don't get that much cool. But if you go to New York, for instance, summers could be beyond 35 degrees centigrade in summer, but in winter could be minus 10 degrees centigrade. So basically, the winters, for instance, get warmer over there in the northern part. But in the tropical region, the winters get warm, but the winter is not as winter as in the north. So basically, the seasonal cycle, I mean the difference between summer and winter. This is higher over there than in tropical regions. So in the seasonal, in the future, you will see more extreme summers and winters, basically, in the northern part, in north, particularly with the continental region. But now, just for the Antarctic, for instance, this is one of the things that the model shows and the scientific community doesn't look that much because we don't know if that's going to happen or not. The same thing with extreme Antarctica. But like I said, the seasonal cycle is responsible. The seasonal cycle is more intense in the northern hemisphere, higher latitudes, as compared to the tropical regions. Okay, basically the difference between summer and winter. In the present, it's small in tropical regions. In the future, will still relatively small. I mean, will it may increase, but not that much as we talk about the extreme regions in there. Okay? Any other question? Yes? Well, for the last assessment report, they will use only the CIMIC 5 for all available models. What I mean, all available models, in reality, not all models have run the same scenario. Some models have run the RCP 2.6, 4.5, and 8.5, but not the 6, for instance. So that's the reason why the number of models, it changes. You see, for instance, here, this is the number of models. And it's not exactly the same, okay? But there are two things. It's like in seasonal forecast, for instance, if I forecast, like for the next season, is rain below normal, this forecast doesn't include the penetration of cold fronts that may produce a lot of rainfall in one particular day. And in case of the climate change, the climate change doesn't represent well the decadal variations. The decadal variations means that you may have a 10-year wetter period in one particular region, but the model may show rainfall reductions on that particular region. The models don't do a good job representing decadal variation. So decadal variation feels more like a, some people say it could be an extension of climate forecast and not climate projection. But as you said, I mean, there are regions, for instance, in northeast Brazil, the forecast for the eastern coast of northeast Brazil was less rainfall than normal. And in 1 week, it rained a lot. But that's more weather forecast. I mean, a weather forecast and climate forecast is supposed to be compatible. But when you have the climate forecast, the weather factors are not there. That's the reason why you have weather forecast and climate forecast parallel to each other. They have to be both. Okay? And as you mentioned, decadal variations are not well represented in these kind of projections. Each model, actually, if you do a decadal analysis, each model will have with different results. At the end, they may show the same signal as in the ensemble. But you may have different results if you start checking all the variation at the 10, 20-year time scale. Okay? So Tercio is asking me to release you for your coffee break. Okay? Short question? I'm sorry, I can't hear you. Where is the microphone? Well, the problem is the selection of the best model, but how useless is the best model? No, I know, but for instance, let's say, remember that all models represent the climate. There are some models that represent quite well the Indian monsoon, and other models that don't represent the Indian monsoon. But some of those that don't represent the Indian monsoon represent quite well the Amazon. You see, so there is no one model that represents the whole climate perfect. That's the reason why with the ensemble you sort of smooth things. Say, but if you want to work for one region, you can choose the best model for your region. But that doesn't mean that these best models you have for your region will be the same best models for another region. I mean, it's a valid way to do research, but you have to choose your own models means a validation of that. And this validation exercise is specific for one region, not for the whole planet, okay? Well, people, then you are released for your coffee, and we will resume soon.